I typically assume that people who come into this course have at least some background working knowledge on how to read and interpret an audiogram, but I do recognize that that's not always the case. So I just wanted to go over the basics here for those of you who may not have had exposure to this yet, or obviously to provide maybe a bit of a review for those of you who have had exposure and might just need to look back at some of the basics. So here's an audiogram that I've created, and I do use this in my classroom. I always have a blank audiogram when I get a new student so that I can jot down his or her hearing loss. And then as they're getting new hearing tests conducted and I'm getting new results from the audiologist, I like to plot it on the same audiogram so that I can see if there's any changes in the hearing loss. If any of you are interested in having this blank audiogram, let me know and I'd be more than happy to email it to you. So there are a few things that you'll need to understand about an audiogram, and one of them is the frequency. So you find this along the x-axis, and frequency is represented in hertz. And basically that just means, you know, how many cycles per second is the wavelength or the sound wave completing. So when we talk about frequency, we're kind of talking about our perception of the sound as pitch. So if you look at an audiogram, you'll notice that on the left side are lower numbers for frequency, and this would be the lower sounds or lower pitch, maybe things like a drum, for example. And as it moves to the right, it goes towards the higher frequency sounds, or the higher pitch sounds is how you would perceive it, and that might be something maybe like a whistle. For those of you who do music, like to play the piano, you can think of this in terms of a piano, where the lower sounds are going to be on the left side, the left keys of the piano, whereas the higher sounds are going to be on the right side of the piano. On the y-axis of the audiogram, you're going to see the intensity or the loudness level. And this basically just means that the quieter sounds are going to be represented at the top of the audiogram, and it's going to get louder as you go down. So here are a few things that we can kind of look at so you can get a sense for where things might be located on audiogram. Here's a dog barking. We all know that dogs can be relatively loud sometimes, and they're going to usually have a lower pitch bark unless we're talking about maybe like a Chihuahua or a Pomeranian or something. For purposes of this, we're going to put this as a lower pitch dog. So a dog barking might be around 70 decibels, and it's at that lower level of the frequency range, maybe between 125 and 250. And again, there's some variability there. I mean, there's going to be some differences in the different ways that dogs bark. On the other hand, we might be thinking about two people having a very quiet conversation, maybe whispering. And as we know, it's going to be quieter. Whispering is quiet, so it's going to be more towards the top of the audiogram. And it includes some of those speech sounds, and some of those speech sounds might be higher up in the frequency range. Again, there's some variability. For example, if there's two women talking, there might be an even higher frequency there as opposed to these two men. This is something you're going to see a lot, and we refer to this as the speech banana. This is not exact. I kind of tried to draw it as best I could, but the speech banana just includes all of those speech sounds. So you can see from the shaded area where speech is, those speech phonemes, where they are on the audiogram. And as teachers of a deaf, if we're wanting our students to learn how to have spoken language and develop spoken language, it's really our goal to make sure that they have access to the sounds within that speech banana. I know a lot of you have had this, but just for a bit of a review, I wanted to go over the degrees of hearing loss pretty briefly so that you can see it represented on an audiogram. So a mild hearing loss is going to be between 20 and 40 decibel levels, that shaded portion on the audiogram. A moderate hearing loss will be between 40 and 55 decibels. A moderately severe hearing loss will be between 55 and 70. A severe hearing loss is between 70 and 90. And finally, a profound hearing loss will be 90 and above. And as you can see on the audiogram, as the degree of hearing loss becomes more severe, it goes down on the audiogram. Here again are those two things that we kind of talked about, and I wanted to show you in terms of the degree of hearing loss. So if we have somebody, an individual with maybe a 40 decibel hearing loss, a mild hearing loss, that person will be able to hear that dog barking, but they may not be able to access these two people whispering because anything kind of above where they are at the 40 dB level is not going to be accessible to them. On the other hand, somebody with a severe hearing loss, let's say maybe 85 decibels across all frequencies, they might not be able to hear that dog even, but they're definitely not going to be able to hear those two people whispering. Here's another way to represent the speech sounds. I really like this. This is from the AG Bell website, and I'll provide that at the end of the slides. But I really like it because it shows not only speech banana, but where those speech phonemes are located within the speech banana. And it provides some visuals for some other environmental sounds. So it gives you a really good representation of where things fall on an audiogram. And that's really useful because when you have your student's audiogram and their hearing loss, and you can compare it with this, you'll be able to see what that student can and cannot access because of their hearing loss. So if somebody has a mild hearing loss, like in the last slide, we can say that if they have a 40 dB hearing loss across all frequencies, they're not going to be able to access anything within that shaded space. So, I mean, they are accessing on this visual representation some of those speech sounds, that speech banana, that the low frequency sounds, maybe like or the vowels, ah, oh, ooh. But you can see even with a mild hearing loss that that student might be missing some of the higher frequency sounds like S, which as we know is really important to the English language because it can change the meaning of a lot of things. You know, we use it for plurals, we use it for possessive. So it's a really important sound. And if this person isn't aided or amplified, they are going to be missing some of those higher frequency sounds. If a student comes and they have a severe hearing loss and no amplification, you can see that anything within the shaded space, they're not going to be able to access through audition. So they're not going to be accessing any of those speech phonemes. They might be able to hear some of the environmental sounds, things like a piano or a lawnmower, maybe a phone ringing, but they're not going to be able to access the speech sounds. And that's really important because as a teacher of the deaf who maybe is teaching listening and spoken language, you want to make sure that a student has access to those sounds. So that's why one of the first components of a listening and spoken language approach is that you're really working on audition. So a child needs to have amplification or they need to be fit with a cochlear implant if they meet the criteria so that they can access spoken language. Here's just kind of a hypothetical hearing loss that I wanted to plot out for you so that you can become more comfortable with seeing it. This is when you see a red circles, it always represents the right ear. So the circles just mean that the hearing test has been conducted through the air. So that's maybe an insert headphone or over-the-ear headphone. And the sound has to go through the outer ear and through the middle ear space in order to reach the cochlea. So when you see red and round, you know that it's for the right side. This hearing loss shows that there's, or this audiogram rather, shows that there's a moderate hearing loss in the low frequencies, and it kind of gently swoops down to a severe hearing loss at that higher frequency level, especially at 4,000 hertz. Kind of like we said before, anything within the shaded area, a student is not going to be able to have access to with this type of hearing loss. This is going to be the left ear, so anytime you see blue or X's, it represents air conduction testing on the left ear. And this hearing loss shows, it shows a moderate, gently sloping to moderately severe hearing loss for the left ear. And again, anything within that shaded portion is going to be what a student can't access. If we show these together, you can see that the left and right ear are pretty symmetrical, but there is a slightly worse hearing loss on the right side. And here, if you want to see it against the background of the different degrees of hearing loss, you can tell a little bit better where it falls. So when you're describing a hearing loss, it's important to be able to describe it in the terms of the degree. So you can see that green shaded area, the moderate area is where the hearing loss begins, goes down to severe in that right ear, but only moderately severe on the left. That's basically it. I didn't want to get into too much detail, but I do want you to be familiar with how to read an audiogram and maybe some things that you're going to see on there. And of course, the importance of making sure that students have access to those speech phonemes. So certainly do contact me if you have any questions. I hope this has been helpful. And let me know if there's anything I can do to explain this further.